this engaging and enlightening talk, Professor Bassam. I have a few questions myself before jumping into the audience questions that I have received. So you have mentioned a number of applications of genomics and medicine. I wanted to know which are of those applications are implemented in the UAE.
Thank you for this kind introduction, but also thank you for this opportunity to speak to so many people, including students and parents. Really, there are several applications already in practice in the United Arab Emirates. The most notable one is in the area of diagnosis of genetic diseases. As you may know, there are about 400 different genetic conditions that have been reported in the UAE. And therefore, their diagnosis is very important for prevention. And therefore, the UAE has established several genomic diagnostic labs in the country, including ones in Dubai and Abu Dhabi and Al Ain. And we've also been very active in the identification of disease genes and mutation. So really, that is a major application. So there is a major application in the diagnosis and prevention of genetic diseases that are, you know, individually rare, but some of them are more common in the UAE. The second application really in the UAE for genomic medicine is in the area of infections or infectious diseases. And as you all know, most of you have been doing testing for COVID regularly on 2 week basis or shorter intervals for some people. And basically that test, which is the polymerase chain reaction or PCR, is based on genetic identification of the virus. And obviously there are other pathogens like bacterial pathogens and other viruses that can be diagnosed at the molecular level are identified by genetic testing. The third application that we are trying to introduce into the healthcare system, not just us, but others also, is to introduce pharmacogenomics, i.e. to use the genetic information of patients for optimizing their therapy, to give them the right medication at the right dose at the right time to reduce the side effects, which will have obviously other potential implications, like, you know, not just suffering or reducing suffering, but also reduce the cost of healthcare system.
Okay, thank you, Professor. I was wondering also if you would define the main barriers to implement genomic medicine in the UAE. What would be those barriers from your perspective?
Obviously, the main value is that with the precision medicine, you are able to design or tailor the therapy to the patient, and therefore you can reduce the suffering and improve the health of the population. Yes. Obviously, we would like to see the population not just live you know, comfortable life, but we want them to have healthy life throughout their lifetime, not just during their young years, and but also in their old age. And therefore, the main, you know, value for this is to reduce the suffering. In addition, obviously, there is economic aspect to actually implementing precision and genomic medicine by reducing the cost, and therefore you are reducing the burden on the public health and also on the economic burden of caring for the population. And therefore, that's another you know, value that is actually very important. So both reducing the suffering, improve the lives and the well-being of the population, as well as making some economic benefits by implementing precision medicine.
Okay, your answer is to shed the light on the values of the importance of the precision medicine. But my question, maybe you did not hear well, it was about the barriers. What could hinder the genomic medicine?
Really, the barriers really, you know, we've done some research on that. We wanted to see what are the potential barriers, and we had some projects related to public health genomics, which revealed that actually the main barriers for implementing genomic medicine in the country is actually the lack of training or limited training and knowledge of most professional healthcare workers. Obviously, genomic medicine is a recent science, and as you all know, and therefore many of those who are working in the healthcare system might not have been through a training and educational program to cover this aspect of medical care. Therefore, the knowledge and the training is a limiting step, but also there are other barriers, like lack of individuals who are trained in bioinformatics and genomics, which are important. And I would encourage young people especially to think of bioinformatics as and genomics as a future field that they would like to specialize in, which will be using both the computing power as well as artificial intelligence for the benefit of healthcare patients basically. Also, there are some barriers related to some misconceptions. People might think genetic testing is very expensive. It is. There are issues with privacy, but in reality, now you can do genetic testing cheaply, and also there are ways of protecting and preserving privacy and so on. The last one I want to mention, really, which I think it's being covered by the establishment of the Emirati Genome Project, is actually we don't have a clear picture of the genetic makeup of the Emirati population, i.e. we don't have a clear picture of the what we call the reference genome. And yes, this is hopefully will be sorted out shortly within the next year or so.
Yes. So speaking of the Emirati Genome Project, Professor, can you tell us about the benefits of this project, the Emirati Genome Project?
Obviously, the main benefit is basically that we will be able to discover and also identify the variations in the population, and especially for us, the variations that are relevant to their health. For example, we would be able to identify if a person is carrying a variation or a mutation that make them susceptible to having a disease themselves, or passing that mutation to their children, and therefore the risk of having a child with a genetic condition. And therefore, we can use this information to reduce the risk of having children with genetic conditions, but also to use the genetic information of an individual basically to tailor their, not necessarily their therapy when they are ill, but actually to prevent the development of the condition. If we know they are at high risk because of their genetic, then those individuals will be able to take precautions. For example, a lady or a person that at risk of developing cancer, for example, they would probably go and do mammography screening and so on. Somebody at risk of developing heart attack because they have high levels of cholesterol in their blood, which are controlled by their genes, then that individual might start their therapy. Maybe they can modify their lifestyle to reduce the risk of developing these what we call the thrombotic events, i.e. heart attacks. So really, these are major application. Obviously, as I mentioned, we can use the genomic information of the individuals as well as the population to optimize therapy for the individuals. For example, we can, in our group, we can take a genome of an individual, the sequence of the pharmacogenes or the genes related to drug reactions, and then produce some sort of like of a card. And I'm sure Dr. Maha will enlighten us on that aspect.
So speaking of the database genome, is there any existing database for the Arab genome currently?
The Arab genome as a whole, there are some efforts in different countries, for example, in Saudi Arabia and now in the United Arab Emirates, as well as Qatar and other Arab populations, to sequence the genome of a large number in their population and establish the reference genome. So there isn't a complete, I think, at least not in the United Arab Emirates or Saudi. But then there is the database that curated by the Sheikh Hamdan Awards in Dubai. It's called Center for Arabic Genomic Studies, where they collected and curated a lot of data on several, maybe 1,000 or 2,000 genetic diseases that are affecting the Arab population. So they have a comprehensive database on genetic diseases and mutations that are found in Arab populations, including the United Arab Emirates.
Thank you, Professor. I have also a question from the audience. Would it be possible to do a genome editing in order to completely remove a disease from a person and stop a particular disease from carrying over the next generation?
The gene editing technologies, obviously, it's been in the news in recent years because of the discovery of something called CRISPR-Cas9 gene editing. And this is very powerful. You can change the genome by modifying or correcting mutations. But obviously, this is not ethical and not feasible to do on embryos or human embryos, and therefore it's not applicable in that sense. What it is applied for in terms of therapy or personalizing therapy is basically for some types of cancers or some type of infections, like in the HIV and so on and so forth, where you can take some bone marrow cells from the person and then genetically modify them by these gene editing technologies, and then put these cells back in the same patient, really. And therefore, you're not changing the whole genetic makeup of the individual, but the cells that are relevant to fighting disease. I just want to go back and just emphasize that actually, genetic manipulations of embryos, of human embryos anyway, it's not ethically acceptable. And therefore, at this stage, it's not applicable where you can take an embryo and genetically modify it and allow it to grow into an individual, because we do not know the overall risks of these genetic modifications and engineering. It's been done on animals and so on and so forth, but in humans, it's still unethical. You can use it to modify, a proportion of human cells, as I said, like cells from bone marrow, for example, and then implant them back into the same patient.
I also, Professor, I want to ask what kind of diseases that you would call a successful story?
Successful stories. I mean, we've been working in the United Arab Emirates universities for many years. I've been here for 15 years, but I have colleagues who spend here about 30 years looking at genetic conditions, and then they. And basically, we've been following many of those families where we managed to identify the disease genes, give the families a diagnosis, and then basically we went even deeper where we looked at the exact cellular mechanism of the disease, what happened at the cellular level, at the tissue level, with the hope of, for example, discovering novel therapies, because most of those genetic conditions are actually untreatable. They don't have therapy or treatments at the moment, and therefore there's a huge need to develop therapies. And one of those approaches is to understand the cellular mechanism and then use that information for therapy. The other potential approach is the gene therapy, where you actually can introduce the correct gene in a form of some sort of what we call vector or vehicle, and then hopefully that will correct the genetic defect. And there are some research being conducted here at the College of Medicine, but obviously worldwide there have been some clinical trials, and in some cases successful clinical trials for treating genetic conditions using gene therapy and other approaches. Example of that is sickle cell anemia that have been treated by gene therapy as well as others.
Okay, I have a question here regarding the treatment of COVID-19, I believe. So the question is like, why, for example, the use of genomics in infection diseases, like the treatment for COVID being developed, has largely focused on the immune response instead of targeting the virus itself?
The main application, at least at the moment, in COVID-19 is in diagnosis, but obviously there are efforts on therapy, and in fact many groups around the world, including us here at the United Arab Emirates, we have projects on trying to develop therapies. For example, we have a project that is funded by the Al Jalila Foundation in Dubai to actually look at a gene in the COVID-19 virus, which is called the M protease, and then design inhibitors, compounds that will block that basically enzyme, and therefore eventually lead to the disappearance of the virus. So there are efforts. They're not successful. I wouldn't say not successful. It will take time. Development of a new medication will take not just months, or probably often been taking about 10 years on average to develop a new drug from the research stage to the further development and then clinical trials. So we expect that there will be some therapies to treat and COVID-19, but it will take time, unfortunately.
Okay. I wanted to also, Professor, if you can tell us about the pharmacogenomics in cardiovascular disease project in the U.S.
Yeah, so basically this pharmacogenomics in cardiovascular disease is a project that is supported and funded by the Ministry of Education, and we are very thankful for that. It's a substantial funding that they awarded us. And basically, cardiovascular disease is the main cause of death in the country, and therefore trying to reduce that burden is very important. One approach is to reduce the burden is by optimizing therapy. And therefore, we decided to embark on this project where we want to look at the genome of individuals who are receiving specific medications. And those medications, one is called warfarin, as I mentioned earlier. Another one is statin. And then the third one is clopidogrel. And those medications, they have specific recommendations based on the genotypes of the individual, meaning it depends on the genome of the person, which we can determine experiment easily, really, by genetic test. And therefore, we want to do this genetic test for those individuals requiring those medications, and then decide on the dosage that is optimal for the patient, as well as make recommendation whether the medication is suitable for them or not. Sometimes we might have to recommend an alternative medication. We don't want the patients to go through trial and error, which you give the medication, try it for 2-3 weeks. They for example, develop side effects, they come back, you try another medication. So we want to do it as early as possible to reduce the suffering of the patient, as well as reduce the, enhance the benefits, basically, optimize the therapy strategy for each patient.
Thank you, Professor. Congratulations on that grant. We wish you
Thank
all
you.
The best.
Thank you.
It was an honor to have you today, Professor. Thank you for joining.
It's my honor to be with you, and I thank you, and I wish you the best of luck, and I'm happy to answer questions later on, by email or by other contact. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.